Yeah, you weren't thinking it with some of the gifts this morning. Hey, I'm no mind reader, but my guess is that probably one or both of these two things would be true for most of us in the room this morning. Firstly, I bet there are a number of people here who are just a little bit fried right now, right? Just a little bit fried. Show of hands, how many here have kids in the family that you're with during the summer, during this Christmas morning? You had kids with you this morning? A few of us? Look, these people with their hands, pray for these people. These are the ones that are really frazzled this morning, and they got here with their kids. I bet getting here this morning was just a little bit intense, right? Just a little bit intense. I can imagine your morning. I can just imagine first thing, ugh. They're up already. All right, I'll hold them back. You make the coffee. And then you just see how the morning unfolds. Look at the time. Hurry up. Open your gifts. Look at the time. We got church. Open the gifts. No, you can't play with that now. We're going to church. Put the present down. You can't play with that. Stop complaining. Eat your cereal. We got to get to church. No, I know you don't want to go to church. I don't really either, but we have to. You just hear the conversations going on this morning. Hurry, get dressed or we're going to be late. You can't wear that. I know you like your gift, but it's a wetsuit. You can't wear that. No, you're not taking your lightsaber to church. You cannot do that. Kids, get in the car now so we can go to church and sing happy birthday to Jesus Christ. Just a little bit like that this morning, maybe. Intense, you know, just a little intense. Family stress, seasonal bad moods. It's a Christmas tradition, right? It's just kind of how things work. My second guess, though, is that a lot of us here are probably just a little bit tired, too, this morning. Just a little bit tired. Late night last night, if you were here this evening, yesterday night. But think about everything you try to cram into the month of December. 80% of all the parties that you attend all year long happened in 3 weeks of December, right? You're out every single night doing these things. And then in the midst of all this busyness and all the parties and trying to finish work for the summer, you think, hey, I know what. Let's redecorate the house inside and outside while we're at it. And all the lights go up and trees come out and hiding everything. And then you say, you know, I got to go shopping. I got gifts to buy for everyone. And you choose to go the same time everybody else goes to the mall right after work. So it's a bunch of lines. And then even though you never bake all year long. You decide, I think I need to make dozens and dozens of cookies. And you burn half of them because the last time you tried baking was last December. And it's just you're getting tired. And while we're at it, why don't we consume 3 times the normal amount of carbs and sugar that I normally intake? We'll do it all right now. So I'm going to feel groggy and moody and hyped out. And then just to make it a little bit more challenging, why don't we let all the kids out of school 2 weeks before I get off work for the summer? And you're just exhausted, right? You're just exhausted. It's intense. It's insane. So breathe, all right? Inhale, exhale. Christmas is done, right? Today we get to relax and enjoy. So I want to ask you to do, as you exhale, just a quiet little prayer between you and God. Say, God, slow me down today. Remind me what the chase is all about. Because today, when we celebrate Christmas, what we're celebrating is Jesus coming for us and how he has impacted so many things. Because of Jesus' arrival, because of his life and his death and his resurrection, people, societies have changed the way they do life. Jesus changed the way people treat children. And children used to be ignored and left in the street. And now people take children in and take care of the least of these. Because of Jesus, compassion for the sick was caught. It was contagious from him. And Christ followers built the very first of hospitals. His inclusion of women and soldiers and lepers and tax collectors and prostitutes created what we now embrace as human justice, as equality of rights, as dignity towards our fellow human beings. And among many things, that things that Jesus changed, it also then changes stuff in us. It impacts the mood of the human race. But how he does that depends on how receptive we are to him. Look at some of the examples. In the very first Christmas story of how moods of people change, we're told about the shepherds in Luke 2, verse 20. The shepherds return glorifying and praising God. Shepherds find out that God is present through Jesus, and they're in a good mood. They glorify, they praise him. It puts them in a good mood. And then we read about angels in verses 13 and 14. Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest." Now, in general, angels are normally in good moods. It's really hard to read in the Bible about a grumpy angel. There are not a lot of grumpy angels in the Bible. And so they're probably already always happy. But here, the coming of Jesus makes them explode in song. He's a mood changer. Another remarkable example of Jesus' arrival, how he impacted people's moods, is Jesus' mother, Mary. She's pregnant with Jesus, and she goes to visit her relative, her cousin, Elizabeth. Elizabeth is pregnant with a son who then grows up to be John the Baptist. All Mary does is walk into the room, and then we read in Luke 1:44, "As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy." What kind of mood was the fetus in? Fetal joy, I guess, is a new phrase now. Fetal joy. Apparently, Jesus just being there has this very powerful mood-enhancing influence, which then brings us to our Christmas story for this morning. Another group of people whose moods were radically changed. In the Christmas story, there are three people we read that go on a great quest, a great chase, a great search. They're called the Magi, the wise men. But we only get a snapshot, right? We only get like a real quick snapshot of what their life and their story is all about. We don't know a lot about them. We know they came from the East. They came from the East and they were searching for something. They were highly educated. They were wealthy. They were from ancient Persia, and they were ongoing learners, quite open to learning about other cultures. They had read the secret writings of Israel, and they were willing to spend a lot of time and effort to go on this great journey, this great chase, to find what they have read about. They were looking for something that was way beyond what money and education and power could bring them. They're called the wise men. We know they're men. We know they're men because if they were women, the Christmas story would have been really different, right? Radically different. They would have asked for directions. They wouldn't have been searching forever. They would have arrived on time. They came really late. They missed the whole birth thing. They would have helped deliver the baby, and then they would have cleaned up the stable, and then they would have labeled and froze enough meals for the next 2 weeks to take care of Mary and Joseph. So instead, they would have brought practical gifts like nappies and onesies and stuff. These guys brought myrrh. What's that about? So we know they're wise men. And these wise men didn't go straight to Bethlehem like they should have. They went to Jerusalem, and they asked in Matthew 2, "Where is the one who was born king of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." See, they would have naturally assumed this is the king. And they would have known a king would have been born in a palace. That's where you find kings, in a palace, in a place of status and power and wealth. That's where kings live. But the child they were looking for wasn't there. But there was a king in Jerusalem, King Herod. Now, we're told in Matthew 2, verse 3, that when Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all of Jerusalem with him. See, King Herod, he thought he was the king of the Jews. See, he was given that title by the Roman Senate, and he was kind of a puppet, really. He was a puppet ruler under Caesar, and he legally had the title King of the Jews. And he was paranoid about this, really paranoid about his power. He had 10 or 11 wives. He only loved one. And the one that he loved, he actually executed because he was afraid she was going to steal his throne. He had sons. He had 3 of his own sons executed because he was afraid they were going to try and compete and take away the crown from his head. When he killed those 3 sons, their barber stood up to King Herod and made a complaint about how he did this to his sons, and that barber then got a very close shave, if you know what I'm saying. At the end of days, right before King Herod died, he was so concerned that nobody would care, so concerned that nobody in Israel would mourn his death, that he gathered 70 of the most influential citizens in Israel, and he had them all executed because he wanted people to cry when he died, even if it wasn't about him. See, that's why we read he was disturbed, that the wise men were looking for another king. See, Herod also had his mood changed by Jesus, but in a different kind of way. And that's why it says all of Jerusalem was disturbed, because if Herod's not happy, nobody's happy. So these magi show up. In addition to this long journey and this being in a strange foreign culture, they have this other bigger problem now. Now they have a very powerful enemy. This Herod character was after him. He's not happy that they're looking to worship a different king. See, now, if I was a magi, I'd be catching the first train out of town, right? I'd be out of there, but they didn't. They were on this great chase to the finish line, and they wanted something that their money and education and power has never been able to attain for them before. They couldn't turn back. They had to keep moving forward, and then they found what they were looking for. They found who they were looking for, and that's when joy kicked in. See, in the strangest of all places, in a world that, as a result, has never been the same, they didn't know who they were looking for, they didn't know really what they were looking for, but they get to Bethlehem, and it's a nothing place, all right? It's just little hick town with, like, a bottle of pyro stuff in the middle, and it's just like, what is this town? It's nowhere. It's poor. It's obscure. It's a hole in the wall. Nobody goes to Bethlehem, but when they get to Bethlehem, we read this wonderful phrase in the Bible, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. They didn't just rejoice. That wasn't enough. They didn't just rejoice with joy. That wasn't good enough. They didn't rejoice with great joy. It was with exceedingly great joy. And that's the contrast. It's very deliberate when you read the story. In Jerusalem, there's Herod. He's got a lot of money, a lot of power, a big palace, a lot of comfort. He has no joy. In Bethlehem, there's nothing. There's no money, there's no power, there's no comfort, there's no palace. But they have exceedingly great joy. What's the difference? What's the difference here? When I look at it, the only difference I see between the two places is Jesus. One place had Jesus, the other place didn't. It was about Jesus. And that's what matters. That's why Jesus' name, Emmanuel, is God with us. You will never be alone. God is with us. Your problems, even in death, you will never be alone. God is with us. See, the arrival of Jesus tells us something that is the most important thing about God. It tells us in a world of mess, because we know the world can be messy, when our lives get in a mess, when our lives get a bit broken, a bit bruised, a bit bumped around, when families get broken, when there's pain and there's injustice, when we read about all the stuff going around our globe, when we feel it in our gut and in our heart, and we shake our head in disbelief of what's going on around us, in the midst of this mess, God is with us. God loves us and has never turned his back on us. He did not try to escape. He did not try to take a break from everything. Instead, he put on his work clothes. He rolled up his sleeves. He humbled himself to be human, and he moved into Bethlehem, of all places, and was born in a manger. Who does that? What kind of God does that? But then there's joy. And the Magi see this, and they know this is God. This is who we have read about. And they rejoice with exceedingly great joy. And that joy then is the same joy that's here now. Christmas Day 2016. I don't have to be defeated by sin, by failures, by doubts. I don't have to be defeated by anxieties and uncertainties and bad things, fear about what might be happening in the future. I don't have to be defeated by what I think might be inadequacies in me or my weaknesses, because Jesus showed up. God is with us. And he says, look, you know, my dad, my father, Yahweh, he loves you. He loves you so much that I will go to the cross to wipe the slate clean for you. I hold your future. Your hope is in the security that I can give you. Even beyond death, I hold it in the palm of my hand. I'll be your friend. I'll be your guide. I'll be your leader if you want. And that's what happens to the Magi. That's what happens to the wise men. This is so strange. They don't belong in this story. It doesn't fit. I don't even let their little figurines be in my nativity scene because they show up years later. They actually don't really belong in the Christmas story. They come much, much later. They're not supposed to be there. They don't come from Israel. They're from a foreign land. They're not part of God's people. And that's why this story's so important and why it affects us. See, the good news is Jesus is here for all of us, for everybody. It doesn't matter who you are, what your background is, what you've done, who you are, what your religion is. He is here for everybody in Israel and outside. You might have a Catholic background, a Protestant background, a Jewish background, a non-religious background. Jesus is good news for you. You might be Buddhist or Baptist or Methodist or Muslim. You might be secular and atheist. You might be American and a Trump supporter. Jesus is good news for you. There is something about Jesus, something about him that is bigger than any other label can contain, any other title, even bigger than what we call Christianity. There's something about Jesus. And these wise guys get it. He's bigger. He's deeper. He's more wonderful. These stargazing strangers, somehow they know. And they followed until they found him. And they fell on their knees. Hearts beating so fast because they realized who was in front of them. They could hardly stand. And they know that this is who they have been looking for, what they have been looking for their whole entire life. And then you know what they do? They go back home. We don't actually know a whole lot about these guys. We don't know a lot about them. We never read about them again in the Bible. We get this snapshot. We get this little short mannequin challenge of a picture. And it kind of slows things down for us to be reminded of what today is about. Who today is about. But that one journey changed their lives. It would have changed their eternity. They found life. So where does this Christmas find you in 2016? What are you journeying towards, questing towards, chasing down? Maybe everything in your life is sweet. Maybe it's all great. Maybe your circumstances are terrific, you look fabulous, your house is wonderful and paid for, your kids are doing fantastic in school, your job is great, your problems are insignificant, your regrets are few. All the relatives that you have visiting with you are emotionally healthy and well-adjusted. Don't roll your eyes, keep looking forward. But maybe Christmas isn't like that. Maybe it's just hard right now for some of us. Where Jesus is, joy will follow. That's what these magi realized. Maybe not fully today, maybe not fully tomorrow, but where Jesus is, joy will follow. Joy will always come. I've seen this. I'm living this out. I watch people all around me find this stuff out. The person laying in a hospital bed after a stroke, body twisted, he feels the presence and love of God. A uni student who fails miserably and is embarrassed and confused about their future, they understand and rely on the presence and love of God. A person who goes through the end of a marriage, there's been a death of a loved one, there's been rejection, betrayal, loss, they find themselves in the arms of God. Someone trapped in a habit, crushing their hope, embarrassment, shame, they hide all the time, full of doubts. And then all of a sudden, they find themselves in Bethlehem. It's not what they expected. And they find themselves in the arms of God. That can be you. That can be all of us if you allow him to be Jesus in your lives. And you make the rest of your life a daily act of unwrapping that gift of Jesus and new life and his love and his comfort and his guidance in your life. See, Christmas reminds us that the most important chase, the most important journey in the world is the journey of the Magi, the journey to find Jesus, and then the ongoing journey with Jesus. Because wise people know that it doesn't matter what you're coming from, it's all about what you're moving towards. And there is no one else more worthy to seek out, to follow, to find. That's why we slow down at Christmas. Let's pray. Just want to give you a little private moment before you go home and start doing lunch and dishes and force yourself to go for a walk out of guilt. And just have a little private moment between you and God as we enter into this holy day of celebrating the birth of Christ. What is the most important thing you could tell God right now? Right now, most important thing between you and God. Just take a moment quietly between you and God. Take advantage of the moment. What is it that you want to tell God? You might be so full of gratitude, you just want to say thanks. You might be really unsure, you just want to say help. Maybe in this moment, if you're really honest, you just want to say, you know what? I've actually never tried this following Jesus thing, and I want to surrender my life to God now. I've always kind of controlled it myself, and I'm willing to give this stuff to him. I want to be like the wise men. I want to fall down on my knees and allow Jesus to be the leader of everything. Allegiance over my life and my time and my body and my mind. Maybe you're sitting here going, yeah, I don't know about this God guy. I'm not really sure he's even there. Take a moment to just commit yourself to keep your eyes open and willing to seek. God, thank you. Thank you that we are reminded on Christmas Day that you are here. And thank you that because you are here, you change things. Moods, outcomes, life stories, and you change them all for the better. Would you please look over all of us in this room right now? Some of us are happy. Some of us are hurting. Some of us are alone. Some of us are just numb. Some of us are just tired. Please pick us up, lift us to your level, and make joy come out of the most unlikely of all places. In Jesus' name, amen.